So the next talk will be given by David Gahan, and it's on time-averaged and time-resolved measurements of ion energy distribution in pulse plasmas, and I think it's very much related also to the first talk.
Okay, so I'm going to present ion energy distribution measurements in pulse plasmas, but the focus is really going to be on the power of the retarding field energy analyzer technology that we use to make the measurements, rather than the type of advanced physics that Gilles is presenting. So this is the outline of my talk. I'm going to start by giving a background overview of this technology, including a motivation for developing this technique. I'm going to explain a bit about what retarding field energy analyzers are. I'm going to mention some design considerations that you need to take into account when designing retarding field analyzers. I'm going to explain the commercial system that we have developed, the Semion retarding field energy analyzer. I'm going to mention a few points about ion energy distributions and what controls the energy of the ions hitting the substrate. And I'm going to mention how you could use these devices to measure an absolute ion flux, which is also a very important parameter for processing. Then I'm going to hopefully validate the capability of this RFEA system using a very simple ICP plasma. And I'm going to present some time-averaged ion energy measurements at a grounded electrode, time-averaged ion energy measurements at an RF-biased electrode, and I'll also show that you can use these devices even to measure a time-averaged electron energy distribution function at the substrate, although it's not as useful as probably the ion energy measurements. Then I'll get to the important part, the pulsed plasma applications. I'll talk about how we've developed the technology to be compatible with time-resolved measurements, and I'll validate this through a series of measurements, time-resolved IDFs in pulsed magnetron reactors, some measurements in a high PIMS reactor, and I'll mention very briefly the pulsed RF measurements, which Gilles has already given a good overview of that. And then I'll just say a bit about what the future is for this particular technology. So the motivation for this particular work. So plasma processing of substrates is very sensitive to the energy and flux of the bombarding ions. Ion energy and flux control very important parameters such as etch or deposition rates. And ion energy has become, the ion energy measurement has become critical for process development, especially when feature sizes and features are becoming more complex. The substrate, unfortunately, from a measurement point of view, are usually processed using some type of electrical bias, which complicates the measurement. And this can be RF bias, typically in the 2 to 60 megahertz range, higher frequencies also. You may have pulse DC excitation, usually up to 350 kilohertz. High PIMS, which involves very short pulses, but maybe low frequency, so the pulse widths may be only tens to hundreds of microseconds. We have applications where tailored bias waveforms are being used to control, to get more control over the bombarding ion energy. And then we have the pulsed RF applications that Gilles was just talking about, which are typically pulsed in the hundreds to tens of kilohertz, but you also have the RF component on top of that to deal with. So these are quite difficult conditions to go about measuring the ion energy distribution. You have to think about electrical filtering of the bias signal. You have to think about high temperatures that may be present in the discharge. And then you have to consider things like your sensor may have a limited lifetime. It may be etched away or coated during the particular process. So time averaged and time resolved IDF measurements are now critical for industrial applications, and I'm going to present our RFEA technology, which can be easily incorporated into most reactors, and it's compatible with most of the bias conditions that we encounter out there. Okay, so what is a retarding field energy analyzer? This is a very simple schematic. It consists of a series of parallel grids and a collector plate. There's an orifice in the lid of the device takes a sample of the charged particles arriving from the plasma. A first grid is biased negatively to remove the electron component, as it would distort your measurement otherwise. And then a second grid is biased with a positive potential to retard, to gradually retard the ions and produce a voltage versus current of ions curve, which can be differentiated to give an ion energy distribution. So there's a few important things you need to consider when designing a retarding field analyzer. The first thing is that the orifice diameter, which takes your sample of charged particles, must be less than the Debye length in the plasma. Otherwise, plasma would form inside the device and your measurement wouldn't be possible. This equation gives the Debye length. And if you plug in some numbers, common electron temperature and reasonably high density, you find that your orifice needs to be quite small in order for these devices to work well. The second thing you need to consider is the ion transit distance through the analyzer. So we want to avoid the situation where ions have collisions with the background gas as they pass through, which would distort the actual ion energy distribution. So we consider the mean free path in the plasma is inversely proportional to the product of the neutral cross, the ion neutral collision cross section and the density of the background gas. And if we plug in the numbers for our particular device, we find that we can operate to about 100 millitorr in argon, which is the worst case scenario, 5 to 10 pascals, that kind of region, without the need for any differential pumping of the device itself. Okay, so just to go to a bit of the background. Before we started to develop this technology, this was the state of the art, which was published by Eric Edelberg back in 1999. They had an ICP etcher at LAM, ICP source, and they built all of their electronics into the RF bias chuck. So this is a kind of a classical approach. If you want to deal with the RF bias, you kind of bring all the electronics and the sensor to the RF bias to avoid any shorting or influence on the RF bias itself. But then you have to communicate the sensor or communicate the signals using optical fibers. So it becomes quite a complicated system to implement. And obviously, commercially, this is not something that you could implement quite easily. You wouldn't be able to go around to people's reactors and redesign their RF chuck. So Mike Hopkins had the idea a couple of years ago. So instead of bringing Moses to the mountain like the old proverb, why not bring the mountain to Moses? So bring the RF bias to a place where you can handle it safely and make it more suitable for implementation in a wide range of plasma reactors. So we placed a sensor on the RF biased electrode, or any electrode. You take the RF bias to a place where it can be filtered and dealt with in a safe manner, and then you can collect the signals in a lot more convenient way and supply the signals to the analyzer in a lot more convenient way. Okay, so this is a typical type of installation. This was in Dublin City University, an Oxford Instruments etching tool, I think. And you can see the analyzer kind of embedded in the powered electrode. And we also did some studies in a Hitachi ECR etching tool. Again, it's a bit more complicated because of these dielectric windows that are present in these type of discharges. But we were able to embed the retarding field analyzer in the electrode and take the signal cabling out through a vacuum tunnel, which it's quite convenient for doing the measurements because it's very difficult to get Langmuir probes or anything else in to these types of device to analyze the plasma. Okay, so this brings us to our own technology. We call the Semion retarding field energy analyzer. It's a compact size, as I said, so it allows it to work to about 100 millitorr without the need for differential pumping. We cover the main orifice with a grid, which is a very small aperture size, which prevents the plasma extending inside the device. A second grade is biased negatively to repel the plasma electrons that would have entered from the plasma. And this grade is swept with a positive potential to gradually discriminate the ions with different energy. The collector plate is biased slightly negative to attract any ions that cross this potential barrier. And a crucial feature of this device is the use of these high impedance filters, which allow the device to be placed on an RF biased electrode or any type of biased electrode and not influence the bias and still allow us to take measurements under those conditions. We've published detailed information on this a couple of years ago, but the filtering is very important. The impedance needs to be quite high so as not to disturb the RF bias, as I said, typically greater than 200 kilo-ohms. It needs to have high attenuation at the output of the filter so as not to damage the electronics. And this is a typical Bode plot for that. We have greater than 60 dB of attenuation over the important frequency range, 400 kilohertz to 100 megahertz, typical for RF applications. And we can push this side back down to 1 kilohertz for applications in the pulse DC industry. So what does the system consist of? It consists of the probe holder itself and a sensing element. And this sensing element is replaceable by the customer. The signal cable takes the signal to a vacuum feed-through, which is mounted on any available port on the reactor wall. And then a box of electronics applies the required potentials to the grids and records the current of ions to generate the ion energy distribution. Okay, so then I guess the question is, what is an ion energy distribution? Well, the shape of an ion energy distribution is largely determined by three things. It's the sheet potential, the length of time it takes for an ion to cross that sheet in front of the analyzer, and to a large extent, the period of any potential waveform applied across that sheet. So for DC sheets, it's quite simple. The potential across the sheet is fixed, and you end up with a nice narrow ion energy peak with an energy corresponding to the time average sheet potential. When we apply an RF bias across this sheet, the situation is a bit more complicated. You need to account for the ion transit time across the sheet, which depends, of course, on the sheet width, the ion mass, and that sheet voltage. The ion energy distribution in this case has been derived quite a long time ago. And if you plot this function, you find that for an RF discharge, you have a bimodal distribution in many cases, where the separation of the two peaks are given by this relatively simple equation. And you can find for most applications, it's one or the other of these two theory are relevant, or a combination of both, say if you're using a pulsed DC bias or a pulsed RF bias, it's some combination of the two. Now, the ion flux measurement is also a very important parameter. So retarding field analyzers do not discriminate between ions of different mass. But what we can do is measure the total positive ion flux arriving at the substrate surface. We do that by placing 0 volts retarding potential on the discriminator grid, and we just collect all the ion current arriving. And you can use quite a simple formula to account for the grid transmission and the collection area of your orifice, where the current density, more commonly known as the ion flux at the substrate surface, is determined by the total current arriving at the collector divided by the transmission of the combination of grids and the area of the aperture. In recent times, there have been some studies, theoretical studies, saying that the alignment of the grid holes plays an important part in your transmission of your sensor. But we've been playing with these things for a long time and we haven't really seen any deviation, even though we make no attempt to align the grids in any way. And a while back, we took a scanning electron microscope image of the collector plate after a couple of months of use, and we see a very regular pattern of the grid in front of it, which would mean that it's almost independent of the grid alignment. Otherwise, you would not expect to see this clear gridded pattern. It would be some confused pattern on the collector. Okay, so I'm going to demonstrate the capabilities of the sensor in an ICP reactor. This was a reactor we used in Dublin City University a few years back. It's an inductively coupled plasma source driven at 13.5 megahertz, which creates and sustains the plasma. We have the retarding field analyzer mounted on an independently biased electrode, as shown here, and we can apply different bias signals to the electrode to control the ion energy distribution, but without changing the general plasma condition. So we can really analyze the effect of the bias on the ion energy distribution. Okay, so we start off with a very simple experiment. We ground the bottom electrode and we do a series of measurements changing the ICP pressure. And we get a series of current voltage characteristics. So what this is showing is that the ion current to the collector is constant until the bias applied to this discriminator grid reaches some value, and then the ion current decays very rapidly to zero because they can't cross for detection anymore. And if we do a series of pressure measurements, we see that the ion energy distribution is a single peak and it's moving slightly to lower energy. Now, we can also use an RF bias to see how that affects the distribution. And I'll keep in mind the two equations that I mentioned earlier. This predicts the theory predicts that the RF bias creates a bimodal distribution with an energy separation proportional to the period of the RF cycle and to the RF bias potential. So if we fix the RF bias frequency and we vary the peak-to-peak voltage, we see that indeed the width of the two peaks separate, as you would expect. So the RFEA performs well in the RF bias condition. We can also fix the RF bias voltage and vary the frequency of the bias, and we find that the width of the two peaks come closer together with increasing frequency. And again, that's consistent with the theory, that the width of the separation is inversely proportional to the frequency of the bias. And then we can do other things like apply different waveforms. So we compare a sinusoidal waveform and a square waveform at the same voltage and same frequency, and we find that we can change the energy distribution quite significantly. And the reason for that is, in the sinusoidal case, if we think of this as the plasma potential and this is the bias potential, during the RF cycle, when the potential approaches the plasma, we get a very low energy peak. And when the bias is well away from the plasma potential, we get a high energy peak. But the difference is that for a square wave pulse, the transition is very sharp from one half of the cycle to the next, and we don't have time to collect ions during this period like we do in the RF bias. And then you can do many other things. We started playing with the bias frequency and started adding multiple frequencies. This was a 2 and 4 megahertz, 2 and 20 megahertz, and you can see that you can really tailor the ion energy distribution by playing with this bias potential. Okay, you can also do a measurement of the electron energy distribution crossing the sheath. This was a study where we compared the electron energy distribution measured with a Langmuir probe to that measured with the retarding field analyzer shown with the dashed line. And actually, you can extend the electron energy distribution function to much higher energies using the retarding field energy analyzer. But the drawback is that the analyzer doesn't collect the low energy portion of the electron energy distribution function like the Langmuir probe, because generally the electrons can't or at least the low energy electrons can't cross the sheet barrier in front of the analyzer. Okay, so this brings me to the main part of the talk, the pulsed plasma applications. And in order to do pulsed, in order to measure pulsed plasmas accurately, you need to do time resolve measurements. And we made a small but very important change to the design, and that is to move the measurement circuit to the other side of the filter, because it's very difficult to get good time resolution through any filter. So this was a bit of a technical challenge, but eventually we solved it. And now we can do time resolution to 100 nanoseconds at bias frequencies up to 350 kilohertz. We haven't quite cracked the RF region, but we hope that may be coming next year. This is the experimental setup I'm going to use to demonstrate the pulse capabilities. It's a capacitively coupled plasma. The sensor sits on the bottom electrode. We power the top electrode with 13.5 megahertz continuous power, and then we apply different signals to the bottom electrode. And we measure the ion energy distribution in the normal way. Okay, so first experiment, very simple. We use continuous wave RF on the top electrode, and we ground the bottom electrode. There are the conditions. And we see that we get a nice monoenergetic, narrow ion energy beam reaching the analyzer as you would expect. Because we're using relatively high pressure, we're getting some ion collisions in the sheet adjacent to the RFEA. But the main point of showing this is to say that the RF bias on the top electrode doesn't really influence the shape of, it doesn't really modulate the ion energy distribution. So we can be sure that when we start applying signals to the bottom electrode, it's any changes we see are due to that bias and not due to any RF potential in the plasma. Okay, second test is to pulse the continuous wave RF at 1 kilohertz. So pulsing it on and off, just as Gilles was doing earlier, 50% duty cycle. Again, the bottom electrode is still grounded. And when you measure the ion energy distribution, we see two narrow ion energy peaks, one which we associate with the on time and one which we associate with the off time, or the afterglow plasma, because the plasma never really decays, we find, in this system in the off phase. But the ion flux, which you can see by the height of the ion energy peak, drops rapidly in the off time. Okay, but of course, there's no time information that you can obtain from this time average measurement, so you need to do the time resolve measurement. And when we do that, we plot the ion energy distribution as a function of time through that 1 kilohertz period. We can map out what the ion energy distribution is doing. So we choose a zero time as some steady state in the on time, and then we look at how it transitions to the off time and then back again as the RF comes back on. And you can see that the situation is not as simple as it appears in the other slide. There is some quite complex things happening with the ion energy distribution on a short time scale. In this situation, this was a 10 microsecond resolution. The few things you can do with this data, you can integrate the ion energy curves to get the ion flux, and you can plot the location of the peak to give you an idea of the plasma potential. Because as I said, the bottom electrode was grounded, so the peak of the ion energy distribution more or less corresponds to the plasma potential. And when we do that and plot it as a function of time, we can see how the plasma potential varies over the RF cycle, or the pulse cycle, and we can also see how the ion flux varies between the on time and how it decays slowly in the afterglow plasma, but never quite extinguishes. I think you would need to have a longer off time for that to occur. Okay, so again, all that is interesting enough, but the real important stuff is when you is trying to do time resolve measurement when you have a bias applied to the substrate. Again, it's more complicated, But for this example, we're applying a square wave pulse to the bottom of the electrode with a peak-to-peak voltage of 60 volts, frequency of 200 kilohertz, and it's a 50% duty cycle square wave. And we do a time average measurement, and we see the two peaks that we would expect, one corresponding to the positive excursion of the bias, low energy corresponding to that phase of the bias, and then a high energy corresponding to the negative excursion of the bias. But again, there's no real timing information that you can get from a time average measurement, so we have to do a time resolved measurement to really figure out what's going on during the pulse. And again, if I plot the ion energy distribution as a function of time through that pulse period, we see that in fact the ion energy distribution is quite complex, and it doesn't respond instantaneously to the transition between the two levels of the bias voltage. So we see that in the off phase, we have a low energy peak, and then it transitions, or at the positive excursion, we have a low energy peak, and then as the waveform transitions to the negative excursion, the high energy peak comes in, but there's a slow decay of the low energy ions. So it's a bit more complicated than you might suspect from the previous slide. Again, we can plot the ion flux by taking an integration of each individual ion energy distribution. And we find that the ion flux of the substrate is not even constant throughout the period of the RF bias. And most theory on RF sheets would use the fact that the total ion flux to the substrate is constant throughout the period of the RF bias. So we can see that maybe this is not always the case. Even though it's not a large modulation, we can see that it does vary due to the applied bias waveform. Okay, that was a square wave bias. We also do a sinusoidal bias, which is more appropriate to the RF community, although it's quite a lot lower frequency, but you can still get the main points. We see the saddle-shaped structure in the time average measurement corresponding to the theory that I showed you earlier. But of course, again, there's no timing information about what's happening during that RF bias period. So when we do the time resolved measurements and we take snapshots at 100 nanoseconds intervals, we can see exactly how that ion energy distribution is changing through that RF cycle. And again, it's not as easy to explain as you might think. There's some complicated structures depending on which half of the cycle you're in, but it more or less follows the sinusoidal shape of the bias. So again, we'd like to extend this up to maybe 2 megahertz, which is more appropriate to the RF community. And that's next on our list to do. If I clean it up a little bit, you can see in a little more detail what's actually happening. You can see the peaks can be narrow in some phases of the RF cycle, but they can be actually quite broad in different phases of the cycle. And this can have an impact on the wafer being processed as well. And again, if we plot the integral of each IDF to get an idea of the ion flux, we see that the ion flux is modulated more or less in the same way with the RF bias period. Okay, so I'll go on to some industrial applications. This was some measurements we took in a pulsed magnetron reactor. You can see the ion energy analyzer is mounted facing the target substrate. And the way this works is a 350 kilohertz pulse DC bias is applied to the target, which ionizes the sputter gas, which causes sputtering of the target, titanium in this case, and then the sputtered particles are transported to the substrate where they are deposited in some sort of thin film. For this particular example, the substrate is floating, and we're going to do time-resolved measurements of the 350 kilohertz target bias. This is a target bias waveform. So you can see it's quite a complicated shape. The pulse comes on in phase A, it's about minus 800 volts, and then when the pulse is switched off, you get this kind of a ringing phase of the target voltage, and then it settles into the off time. And if we do a time average measurement of the ion energy distribution, we can see these three distinct phases appearing. A is the dominant feature, a low energy peak due to the stable on time of the plasma. B is due to the ringing phase of the plasma when the plasma potential can be shifted to very large positive voltages, and the ions arriving in that phase can have quite high energies. And then in phase C, in the kind of stable off time, we get these higher energy, maybe 50, 60 EV ions in that phase. But of course, we're assuming this is the case, but we've no, up to this point, we had no time information about that. But by doing the time-resolved measurements, we can see this a lot more clearly. So as we transition through this bias period, we can see how this low energy peak develops as the plasma comes on, how this high energy distribution occurs in this ringing phase, and how it starts to settle back with these kind of medium energy ions in this off phase before starting the cycle again. So this technology is very useful for understanding what's going on as a function of time through that pulse period. A second example is some work we did in a high PIMS reactor at Linköping University. This was a 2-inch target. It was sustained at 15 millitorr using argon sputter gas, and this is the substrate holder facing that target where we have mounted the retarding field energy analyzer. There's two modes you can operate this system in. You can operate it in a pure pulse DC mode, or you can operate in what's called a high PIMS mode, which is a short burst, maybe 10 to 100 microseconds of power to cause high ionization for a short period to improve deposition rates and so on. And we have two examples of this. Here we take the ion energy distribution as a function of DC bias applied to this substrate holder. And we see if we leave the substrate holder at a floating potential, we get what you might expect, quite a low energy peak. And then if you apply a high voltage, negative voltage to the substrate, you can accelerate the ions up to large energy. But when we switch to the high PIMS mode and we apply the same negative bias to the substrate holder, we get some very interesting features that the team there were not able to really explain at the moment. But you get not only this high energy peak, but you get a kind of a smaller sub-peak. And to understand this in more detail, again, we have to go to the time resolved measurements to see exactly what's going on through the high PIMS pulse period. And we plot that ion energy distribution as a function of time through that period. And we see in the early stages of the high PIMS firing, we don't actually get any ions. It takes 25 to 30 microseconds before the ions start to arrive. They start off with, say, 80 EV of energy. And then after some time, they suddenly transition to this higher energy. Again, we're not exactly sure why that occurs. Maybe some of the experts might be able to explain that a bit better. But it just shows you the power of using this technology to do time-resolved measurements. One last example. It's a very simplified version of what Gilles was showing earlier. We mount the retarding field analyzer in a capacitively coupled plasma where it's powered with a 13.5 megahertz continuous working source. And we apply a pulsed, but a continuous working 2 megahertz to the bottom electrode, and also a pulsed 2 megahertz bias to the bottom electrode. And we can see the continuous bias causes the standard saddle-shaped structure. But if we start to pulse that bias, we can actually deplete the high energy peak and start to populate the low energy peak using the pulse. But again, We can only do pulsed RF in time average mode. We haven't developed the time resolve functionality for that yet. And the problem really is that we have such a wide frequency range to account for. So the pulsed component is at hundreds to kilohertz region, while the RF is at 2 to 60 megahertz. So it's a bit of a challenge there to develop the time resolve functionality for that particular application. Okay, so that really brings me to the end of my talk. I'll just give you some information on what's coming next for this Semion technology. The first thing coming out in the next couple of months is a spatial version of the analyzer where you can do spatial uniformity mapping of the wafer. And then later in 2013, we hope to be able to do the time-resolved pulsed RF measurements, which I think would be very useful to GEOs. He probably has dibs on the first one of those coming out. So thank you for your attention, and feel free to ask any questions.
Yeah, thank you for a nice talk. Guess we have many questions.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I was using that for most of the mistake. I have a question about the magnetron case in which the you showed no previous one. One more. Oh yeah, this one. And in this case, the positive phase voltage in the next slide is that is also very high voltage, but that voltage is less than 300 volt, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But
this peak here?
But yeah, the energy which is observed is around 300 volt. What's the reason for this?
Okay, well, this may not be the exact waveform that was used for this exact ion energy measurement.
No, I'm wondering.
So, in other words,
there's any artifact in the measurement system or not?
No, I think we just took the wrong waveform. I think this the particular waveform that generated this ion energy distribution had a ringing that was much higher.
Okay.
So it was up around the 300.
So you expect that much more higher energy. And in the case of the rectangular previous ones. And in the next slide, what's the reason why this ion energy and this ion energy is coexist, even though the voltage is turns to the opposite at this moment, right?
Yeah, I guess that is related to the ion transit time across the sheet. So the ions don't respond instantaneously, so they have some memory from the previous phase of the waveform.
This measurement system is capable with a 10 nanosecond or 100 nanosecond time resolution.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So I don't think this is an issue with the resolution of the analyzer. This is more to do with the ions crossing the sheath. So the actual sheath potential that the ion sees doesn't change instantaneously.
But in this case, the diagnostics is on that electrode. It means that that is on that potential, right?
The electrode is at that potential.
Yeah.
But the important
and
potential,
the energy
is
which is measured here is in that instrument, and it means that the energy which is entering the instrument.
Yes, but it's not the potential on the instrument that controls the energy. It's the potential dropped across the sheath in front of the instrument that controls the energy.
Because in the sensorial case, yeah, it shows a very reasonable result.
Okay, we should talk about it later, yeah.
How does the results that you've got here, how does sort of resolution and things change if they were negative ions rather than positive?
Well, funnily enough, with negative ions, it's very hard to detect them with this type of system. Purely because, let's see, have I got a diagram? Oh yeah, so say this diagram, for example, there's always a sheath in front of the analyzer. So negative ions are created in the bulk, but they're usually confined to the bulk, unless there's high energy.
You've got a pulse system where you get rid of that.
Oh yes, well then, yeah, if you were to do time resolve measurements in the afterglow, you would have to wait for the electrons to leave, obviously, But then after, say, 10 or 20 microseconds, you would only have negative ions left, and you could measure them.
You expect similar performance?
The same resolution. The resolution doesn't change, yeah. The only thing is, what is the total flux of the negative ions? You need to have enough sigma to measure.
Other questions? But doesn't seem to be the case. So okay. We have well in time for a coffee break. Thank you very much again.
Okay.